Now, I'm really excited to introduce our next speaker. Eric Lee is an undergraduate at Harvard studying computer science and economics. As a second-generation immigrant of parents from rural China, he found his passion for social impact at a young age as he better understood how systemic inequalities severely disadvantage marginalized people across the world. Combined with his Gen Z upbringing, where he's seen how technology has changed the way people live and operate, Eric wants to use technology to catalyze positive change. He leads Harvard's Computer Society Tech for Social Good, T4SG, which is a student-run social impact tech group with the mission to empower student leaders to leverage technology to tackle the world's big problems. T4SG's flagship program is their technical consulting, where they host semester-long collaborations with nonprofits, government agencies, and social enterprises. Separate from his work on campus, Eric has taken a leave of absence this past year to pursue social impact tech in industry, working at the Ag Tech International Development nonprofit, Precision Development, and across environmental projects at the social enterprise Incubator X. Longer term, Eric is interested in social entrepreneurship in the sustainable development space. So welcome, Eric. We're so happy to have you. Eric's going to be joining conversation with our own amazing Sanmaya Mohanty, who is our virtual summit assistant at Powerfly and master of the conversational interview. So please feel free to take it away, Sanmaya.
Yeah, thanks for that introduction, Meg. Hi, Eric, how are you? Glad to have you speaking with us at the Tech for Social Impact Summit.
Hey, Sanmaya, I'm doing well. Yeah, just wanted to just say thank you for this opportunity to speak here. And Meg, thank you so much for the introduction. Really excited for this.
Absolutely. So can we start the session by having you tell us a bit more about yourself and your career journey so far?
Definitely. Yeah. So I think the story really starts with my parents. I think as Meg had mentioned, my parents grew up in rural China, sort of in poverty. My mom, she walked miles to school every day, and she, it was always a question as to where the sort of the next meal would come from. In contrast to, I think, my personal background, I grew up in suburban Houston. I was fortunate enough and privileged enough to always know that my next meal would be there when I came home. I had really loving and amazing parents who were always there for me. And I think this sort of, contrast, helped me understand that, I have this immense privilege. I have this immense privilege that allows me to, not have to worry about some of these problems that, millions, billions of people across the world do. And sort of some of my, concerns when I was young about, I don't know, what am I going to eat for lunch? Okay, how can I solve this math problem? Aren't necessarily the challenges that, the world is facing. Absolutely. And I think with this sort of, privilege, I think that really, really led me to understand that, I ought to sort of do good rather than contribute to, systems that created this sort of inequality around the world. So with that said, when I was younger, sort of my sister and I, we started with a lot of community service, throughout elementary and middle school. We did a lot of disaster relief, some digital literacy work. And that was the sort of frame I came into Harvard with as, a computer science concentrator or a computer science major. I really wanted to figure out, I know I have this passion for technology and I wanted to apply that to, the positive good. So with that said, when the pandemic hit, I think it, just personally emphasized to me how these huge systems like, the global healthcare system are, it may seem like this massive, operating like institution that, can't go down, but it's like there are tons of holes within it. And these sort of massive systems are like extremely vulnerable. And throughout the pandemic, especially, for me, I was fortunate enough to have, more time in that process. I realized that, if I wanted to start this process of doing good, and if I really wanted to, commit my life or my career to, social impact, I can't just start later on. There's huge problems that sort of need to be tackled now. And I can't just wait until, I've graduated, wait until I've gotten more experience or wait until some other thing happens that sort of gives me that. I should go ahead and get started. And with that said, that was sort of the onus behind launching Harvard Computer Society Tech for Social Good. At Harvard at that time, there had been no space for students interested in this intersection of tech and social impact. And with the support of some really great people and with the support of Harvard Computer Society, our parent organization, we launched Tech for Social Good and, it's been able to grow with some really incredible and amazing people in it.
Yeah, I mean, so your story is so inspiring, right? Right. I mean, there are things that we take for granted, right? I mean, that's not available to billions of people. I totally connect with you with that. And yeah, the thing that you mentioned about, you know, our healthcare ecosystem, it looks so big on the outside, but you know, when the situation arrives, it just crumbles like dominoes. So yeah, I mean, so people like you are taking the initiative, and that's great. So we'd love to know more about, you know, Harvard Tech for Social Good. So as you said, you know, so Harvard is always known for its academic rigor, right? So how was it perceived amongst your peers? How was it perceived amongst other people? Like how, I mean, other people who are maybe more career driven. So how did it totally unfold?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, I think Tech for Social Good is unique in the sense that from the get-go, it was catered to really be accessible and interesting to all. For some context, Harvard's computer science department is very theoretical. You know, focuses a lot about math, a lot about, you know, theory, a lot about proof, stuff like that. That sort of provides students this opportunity to, you know, understand, okay, what's driving the, I guess, sub layers of computer science, but less about the actual, okay, let's be coding, like on the ground, you know, maybe building products. So that was sort of also one of the onuses behind the development of the organization. You know, there's Tech for Social Good is one of the only ways to build tangible technical skills on campus. And what that means is that even for folks that, you know, are less passionate or not as passionate about social impact tech, or, you know, may not have that drive within them, they can still learn and use their work and talent and skills for positive impact. Furthermore, you know, Tech for Social Good are one of our core tenets is that we work with and interact with real clients. So we work with, you know, NGOs, philanthropic organizations, government agencies from like the Clinton Foundation to the USDA. Mm-hmm. And these clients are creating real world impact. And what this means is this provides a real learning opportunity for those interested in the social impact sector. You know, not only is it, not only are you doing that actual work, but you're learning, okay, you know, how is this, you know, how is the, like the ACLU, how are they structured? You know, how mm-hmm. at a high level, what is their sort of like information technology strategy, understanding that piece. And the last part of that too, is just, you don't need significant technical experience in computer science to get involved, or nor significant experience in sort of community service or social impact. You know, we want it to be a way where people can get that initial experience, where people can, you know, find that passion, find that work, do that, you know, inspiring work. So that was how, you know, it was initially, I guess, conceived, and sort of as a result, you know, it was received with a decent amount of interest. I mean, we were definitely smaller in our first semester, you know, where our trial trying to figure out, okay, does this sort of model work? And that was last semester. And since then we've grown with even more clients this past semester, you know, higher quality work and generally having more of a foundation on campus.
Great. I mean, I really love the idea that, you know, when you said, so it's a theoretical course, so kind of masquerading the social impact under the utility. So yeah, I totally love that approach. So from the time that you have taken the tenure for Tech for Social Good, so what are some of the initiatives that you have started? So could you run down a bit on that?
Yeah, by all means. So I just wanted to caveat that, you know, none of these are exactly initiatives that, you know, I myself developed, but rather really in, you know, coordination and often led by and sort of pushed forward by, you know, tons of other really great people within the organizations where I, you know, just play a bit of more of a supporting role. But I remember, you know, two semesters ago, Sarah and Milan were sort of our, you know, first project managers who, you know, I really like got our, you know, software engineering, technical consulting projects off the ground. Their work has sort of now been taken forward and overseen by our directors of engineering, who are Derek and Gavin. We recently started a UX, UX research and design technical consulting service led by Vanessa and Leah, sort of our directors of UX. We launched a social entrepreneurship winter program for students interested in that space to find teams and walk through what is the ideation process and validation process for coming up with ideas, which was led by Derek, who I mentioned was director of engineering. We've pioneered a social impact ideation session with Harvard's largest CS class, and are currently working on launching a fully student-run class to do this sort of social impact tech work and help students get course credit for it, which is being pioneered by April, our director of growth. Tulsi, our director of marketing, is, you know, creating ways for non-technical students that are interested in marketing to still get involved and really extend the reach of this sort of social impact tech work. And also, we're also better understanding how we as an organization, as well as Harvard as a whole, can engage better with technology ethics and ensuring we're as accessible as possible. I mean, that's sort of being led by Isaac, our Director of Inclusion, Equity, Diversity, and Ethical Tech. We're doing lots of things in these different areas. Happy to talk about any of them more thoroughly, but I just also want to emphasize that, much a collaborative effort, a lot of really great people within Tech for Social Good doing a lot of really great work.
Totally. I mean, that was a lot of, portfolios under your consulting program. So how was just, just run me through the challenges you faced through when you were starting with the program. So with the consultancy program, so was it difficult to get the initial clients on board, or how was it? Because you are still a student. And so as a student body, how difficult or how easy it was, or how challenging it was to get those first, clients on board?
Yeah, that's a great question. It definitely wasn't an easy process. We have right now, we have a whole team at the moment dedicated to this client sourcing to try to find what are the best projects we can work on. I think one of the most interesting things is not just that it can be hard to find clients in which, our focus is providing pro bono support. So usually clients are receptive, though, it's a balance trying to make sure that our skill sets, our experiences are able to be a good fit with the client. The thing about our work is that because we focus on custom technology development, mm-hmm. that means that clients need to have pre-existing technical abilities. And this is always something, interesting that we found is just that a lot of organizations want to use tech, and we find that a lot of the organizations that don't have that existing technical ability are often the ones that sort of need it most. But the problem is if we build some sort of custom website, custom platform, custom anything for them, what will happen is that and just by nature of how technology works is it'll, break. It, maybe a package goes out of date, maybe something gets updated by somebody else, and as a result, what will happen is just that what we built will no longer be useful, and they no longer would have our sort of technical experience, because from our side, maybe our team members had graduated, or maybe our team members are no longer part of the organization. So that's one of the, one of the things that we think about a lot when we sort of do this sourcing, making sure that, if we build something, can it be carried forward? Can it be maintained? Can it be implemented? When we're thinking about, if we're building a product, are we sure that we can talk to the end users of this product and make sure that, we're not just building for the sake of building, but, we're building to solve real problems and these will actually help real people. So it's often this sort of balance, not just understanding, what projects we could work on, but making sure that, we can provide the most value to the organizations that we work with.
Totally. I mean, it's making sure that the work that you do stays with them for time to come. That's absolutely necessary. So adding on to the onus of balance. So with your background in tech, what is the primary reason that you think is behind the misalignment of tech and social good in most initiatives?
Yeah. That's a really great question. I think I'm definitely no expert on this. I'm still learning. I'm still reading. I'm still getting a better understanding of this. But from my perspective, I think there are two ways to think about this. One is thinking about the general tech industry. So this is the for-profit tech industry, and the other is sort of thinking about efforts that try to do good or explicitly do good using technology. So starting with the general tech industry. I think there's two primary reasons for misalignment. One, I think, is just the catch-up nature of regulations on innovation and technology. At the end of the day, government is slow. It's reactionary. It's less proactive. It often is figuring out, okay, this happened. How do we prevent this from happening in the future, right? We can see this with the COVID pandemic, right? Absolutely. There was Obama had instituted a pandemic task force in which it's been completely abolished, right? And as a result, what happens is that technology is built with the use case in mind, and the regulations to make sure this technology doesn't hurt people comes much later on. We can see this now through social media companies like Facebook, Twitter. Mm-hmm. How are they dealing with questions of free speech, disinformation, misinformation? How are like every organization's policies are a little bit different. There's no uniform thing. It's a constant question of like, what's the fairest way? What's the most ethical way? What's the most equitable way? So I think that's one piece of it. And I think the other piece of it is just, you know, as a result of sort of being in a, you know, more capitalistic system, you know, companies as a whole haven't historically needed to be accountable for what they're doing, for totally. What sort, you know, how they're building their products, you know, who is it affecting? Because as long as it affects their primary user in a positive way, that's all they're really focused on. And it's really not been until recently that, you know, consumerism has started to take into consideration this like idea of corporate social responsibility. And just understanding, okay, you know, you're selling clothes, but how are you producing these clothes? You know, are you sort of exploiting local labor for it? Or are you sort of, you know, violating laws in that process of doing so? You know, I don't think, you know, this is a perfect alignment yet, but, you know, I think we're, you know, moving in the right direction. Totally. But yeah, so for the general tech industry, I would say those two things. Just one, another quick point on sort of efforts that use technology to do good. I think one book that really opened my mind and opened my perspective on this is this book called Geek Heresy. And it's called, the full title is Geek Heresy, Rescuing Social Change from the Cult of Technology. And as somebody who is trying to do good social change through technology, I think it was really insightful because it talked a lot about how technology is this amplifying force. It's not necessarily positive. It's not necessarily negative. But what it does do, it amplifies the existing patterns and existing systems, right? So we often think about like technology as, oh, maybe like Facebook has provided this opportunity for people to get connected. Well, the thing is people have already been getting connected beforehand. You know, email, how different is email from like, you know, seeing people's status updates, you know, fundamentally not that different. And what technology has done is it just made that easier, right? It hasn't necessarily revolutionized the whole game of communication. It's just made the communication in ways that we've already wanted to easier. And as a result, I think a lot about this sort of idea of like tech utopianism or tech saviorism, in which, you know, we want to make sure that we don't think that we can throw technology at any problem and it'll solve it. Because at the end of the day, you know, the real focus on, or the real issue behind a lot of these problems is the systems behind it and the people that are affected, the policy, the process, like what's actually happening. And if we throw like a mobile app at some community, that's not going to fix all their problems.
I mean, throughout this conversation, I was jumping off my chair. I was totally connecting with you on so many levels. So, you know, just like 2 or 3 hours back, we had this conversation with Sasha Lipman, who's the founder of Tech to Impact. She mentioned this line that technology is nothing more than the people who are behind it. And, you know, as you rightly mentioned, technology is just an enabler or a disabler based on, you know, where you stand from, what's your perspective like. So I totally agree with you. And maybe we could share the book that you mentioned. Maybe we could share the link with our viewers so that, you know, they could go on and read the perspective that actually opened your eyes. So moving forward, let's move to your personal journey. And so now you'll be starting. So you have started your internship at Google recently. So we'd love to know how you tie your future ambitions as a software engineer or as someone in the tech field to your work in the social impact domain.
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, I think at a baseline, my long-term goals are, you know, 1000% in social impact tech, specifically social entrepreneurship. You know, it's a field in which, you know, I can see, you know, firsthand how it's the most efficient way to sort of 10x impact, to really be innovating outside of the box. Specifically thinking about, you know, my current role as Google, you know, I'm definitely grateful for this opportunity and you know, to be able to be at an organization like this. And I'm viewing it in, you know, in two ways. One is an opportunity to gain technical experience. You know, building what is it like building software, building technology at scale that's, you know, reliable, secure, safe, while being surrounded by some of the best engineers in the world. And you know, I've had a lot of really great mentorship from, you know, my manager and my mentors and other people I've met at the organization. But it's also, you know, I think for me, a stepping stone to get involved in some really other exciting social impact tech work. For example, this past spring, I interned as a climate intern at X, which is Google's sort of incubation engine. And you know, what had happened is I got connected to a Harvard alum working there who was doing really exciting work looking at what are the What are the environmental social enterprises that they're building, and what is the, like the market strategy of their? And this has been helping me in the sense of, you know, I'm interested in social entrepreneurship. I'm interested in social enterprises, and as well as like better understanding how to improve tech for social goods work for these organizations. But yeah, so I would just say that, you know, I think I'm really trying to leverage this opportunity to gain technical experience and sort of how I can get involved in other parts of Google that are really social impact aligned. And at this moment, I'm thinking that in the context of sustainable development, to build sort of healthy and resilient economies around the world, you know, in part inspired by sort of my climate work at X, as well as the previous internship that Meg had mentioned, where I worked at Precision Development, an ag tech nonprofit.
Totally, totally. So yeah, basically, you know, you're using it as a pathway to catapult your journey into, you know, tech for social good in the future. Totally, totally in sync with you. So while I was, if somebody goes through your link, so you have had a quite illustrious career so far, and your LinkedIn is totally filled up with so many tasks. So how do you manage it while continuing your undergraduate study? How do you manage a balance between academics and the numerous initiatives that you're involved with, like for instance, social impact initiatives? So how do you do this?
Yeah, that's a, you know, it's a great question. Again, you know, it's one I'm also in the process of figuring out. I think for me, what this past year, you know, not having been in school and sort of being on this leave of absence, has taught me a lot in the sense that I've been able to do some really exciting on the ground work, right? I've been able to look at market strategies for, you know, environmental organizations that, you know, need profit streams as well as need to do impact. I've been able to, you know, work, to understand what are the programs that, you know, that the nonprofit is putting out, you know, how effective are they? How can we sort of balance resources among those? And for me, I think I've come to understand that even as a student, you can make a lot of impact. And being a student is not necessarily just an intermediary step. It's not necessarily like, you know, I learn a bunch and then later on I'll do impact. What you can do is you can really, you know, as a student, you can go ahead and get started in that. And as a student, you have this real ability to make a significant difference. So I think for me, I've just, in sort of my time, I definitely appreciate, you know, the academic piece of it, in which, you know, I'm learning a ton and, you know, I'm surrounded by really great professors, other students, and you know, I'm really getting that sort of intellectual development. But I think for me, you know, I really want to further focus in on, you know, what, while I am at this, you know, place surrounded by, you know, I guess 1600 other really great students, how can I, you know, leverage that to, you know, make an impact, you know?
Totally, totally. So just now you spoke about your leave of absence in the past year. So what motivated you to take this decision? What was the rationale behind it?
Definitely, yeah. I think the first push was just for me personally, we sort of went virtual in the middle of our of the spring semester. And as a result, school became, you know, a lot more difficult and definitely less enjoyable when it did become virtual. You know, I think for me, a big part of what, you know, college experience is that, you know, social element of it, you know, meeting other people, being around really inspiring other people, seeing, getting those, you know, creative juices flowing, or, you know, with others and sort of having that collaborations. So as a result, you know, going into the summer, I really wanted to at the very least keep my options open. You know, I was like, you know, I'm not quite sure whether or not I want to take this leave of absence, but I want to at least explore, if I didn't, what would I get involved with? And I found this really exciting product opportunity at Precision Development, where I'd get to really hone in on one of their new programs and figure out how can we launch a new program in sort of in a human-centered design manner. And then going into the spring, I was still thinking about that. And I was like, okay, well, given this sort of past semester in working at this nonprofit, I was really excited by that on the ground work and really like learning by doing. And as a result, you know, I sort of joined X. And I think just really this has taught me that, you know, I really like this work that's, you know, less theoretical, that's really making an impact on real people, and which I can see that, you know, if I'm doing this work, you know, there's this ownership of, you know, X input leads to Y output, right? The harder I work, the sort of more impact I can make. And I'm excited, you know, don't get me wrong, I'm excited to go back to school in the fall. But yeah, I couldn't have been happier with my past years and students.
Totally. I mean, I totally agree with you that, you know, the biggest thing, the biggest factor of going to school is the networking thing. And this pandemic has obviously made things a bit difficult. And I totally agree with you that it was indeed a great decision to, you know, pursue your other interests in this time. So as we are ending towards the time of the session, so let me just ask you, sum up this session by this final question that I have. So you are a Gen Z, right? So how come, I mean, just tell us about how your Gen Z upbringing changed your perspective towards the impact of tech for pioneering social good. How was the process like?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a great question. And I think for me, just growing up around technology, you know, it's really significantly, you know, changed what life is like, you know, how everyday life works. For example, now, you know, staying in touch with friends around the world, so that I mentioned, you know, is, you know, I can call up any friend at any moment. You know, it's a different perspective. You know, I can see, you know, how tech has this possibility to make an impact, right? Information on the internet, you know, libraries, you know, you don't necessarily need to go to a library to find the information you're looking for, right? Everything, everything's just like a second's notice that, you know, if you just, you know, search something up. And I think for me, that showed me that, you know, while life has, I guess, you know, change, or while technology has sort of altered how we sort of approach life and how we walk through it, it also means that, you know, tech has this real potential for impact when used correctly. And I think just having been able to grow up around tech and see, you know, firsthand that, you know, has really helped me understand I want to use tech to make an impact.
Totally. So now we have a question from the chat. So Craig asks, do people have to be at Harvard to participate in your program?
So unfortunately at the moment, yes. We are thinking about ways, how can we better engage with other, you know, other people, other schools, other organizations. But at the moment, you know, all because we're sort of Harvard Computer Society, Tech for Social Good, we are focused on that. We just want to make sure, you know, we fully develop out our organization and make sure that we're operating as smoothly as possible before we think about expanding outwards.
Totally. It has been a great summit so far. And at the end, I want to wrap it up by asking you that for everyone tuned in, how can we connect with you and support you in your endeavors?
Yeah. Well, first and foremost, yeah, thank you so much, Sanmai. It's been a great conversation. It's really always a pleasure. And thank you to the whole Power to Fly team for this opportunity. But yeah, specifically how we could be supported. I think, you know, following Tech for Social Good on LinkedIn, okay. It's just HCS-T4SG. You can sort of keep updated with as our projects develop, as our work develops. And the other thing too, is we're also trying to develop a sustainable funding stream at the moment. So if anybody's in touch with potential sponsors or funders sort of looking to get involved in the social impact tech space, that would also be very useful. But yes.
Thank you so much, Eric. Thank you so much for being with us at the summit. And yeah, with that, we wrap the session. And Meg, you can take the podium. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Eric and Sanmaya. That was absolutely amazing and a really, really interesting program.